हाय व्यूअर्स, आई एम डॉक्टर एम अश्रम मधुरू, प्रोफेसर ऑफ कम्युनिटी मेडिसिन। आई वेलकम यू इन द सेमिनार कम्बैटिंग पैंडेमिक कोविड-19। दिस इज द सेकंड सेशन ऑफ दिस सेमिनार एंड इट इज फोकस्ड ऑन द डिजीज सर्विलेंस एंड रिस्पॉन्स। लेट्स सी द हाईलाइट्स। द हाईलाइट्स ऑफ दिस सेशन: जनरेशन ऑफ हेल्थ अलर्ट्स, इंटरनेशनल रिस्पॉन्स, local disease surveillance and response, disease surveillance stakeholders, suspect finding and management, contact tracing and management, dealing with cases and probable cases, public health awareness, isolation, quarantine and social distancing, and personal protections. So these are the highlights of this session. Let's take one by one. Health alert generation for the COVID-19, a suspect case meeting clinical case definition of COVID-19 is an alert and to be reported and investigated immediately. For epidemic criteria, one confirmed case is sufficient to trigger the epidemic in a given territory. While we are talking about the across the countries and across the nations, if the confirmed cases of COVID-19 are reported from across the countries, then it will be declared as an epidemic, as WHO has already declared on 11th March that the COVID-19 is a deadly pandemic and great threat to the humanity at the planet. Then the stakeholders of the disease surveillance response system, they are international stakeholders, United Nations and its related institution, World Health Organization, UNICEF, financial institution related to international institutions, they are also the stakeholders in disease surveillance and response. At national level, Government of Pakistan and all provincial governments and district health authorities, they are the stakeholders. And the frontline fighters against the COVID-19 are the healthcare providers. That includes specialists, doctors and nurses and paramedical staff and dealing with the patients and present in the health institution. I salute them, and they are the stakeholders in disease surveillance and response. The community as a responsible citizen is a major stakeholders and end beneficiary of all the disease surveillance and response. Let's take a review of the responsibilities. And the international responsibilities are promulgation of international health regulation, international disease surveillance and response, and providing technical and financial support to the affected states. Then the national institution, they should have the responsibility. They should have setting and activation of district health disease surveillance and response system, the healthcare of exposed and unexposed, the communication and coordination with international health agencies is the responsibility at provincial and national government level. The healthcare provider, they are responsible for capacity building and adjusting the health facilities according to the healthcare for the COVID-19. And provision of healthcare to exposed and exposed population, and self-protection is the responsibility of the health stakeholders. Then community as a responsible citizen, they should abide the laws and the responsibility at their shoulders. The social distancing, personal hygiene and volunteering for contact and suspect is the responsibility of the community. These are the major stakeholders. We will discuss responsibilities of international, or we now move to the international response. The disease is declared as a public health emergency of international concern already by the WHO. Then WHO also have declared it as a pandemic. Then there is a morbidity notifiable as per confirmed disease criteria. It has been set by the WHO and CDC. The international mapping is on for morbidity and mortality. You daily see how many cases internationally they are there, and country-wise detail. There are so many softwares, international softwares, they are working and mapping the disease on the map. Then provision of financial and technical assistance is also on for to combat this epidemic. The local responsibility, the protection of the population by restriction of movements. Then screening and capacity building of healthcare delivery system for COVID-19. This is the great responsibility at the shoulder of the local governments. Then establishing a system of clinical case management for all type of cases, ensuring public health measures like social distancing, home isolation, and legal and self quarantines, the public health awareness. So these are five summarized responsibilities of local disease surveillance and response team. Then disease surveillance response team, according to Government of Pakistan guidelines, they have divided the whole of the community into three categories. One is the suspect category, other is the contacts, and other is the population at risk. So the suspects, they are categorized from mild to severe symptoms plus the exposure history. Taking into consideration, they are in category A, B, C, and D. On the other hand, the contacts, they are divided into level 1 and level 2 depending upon the risk of exposure and the severity of the exposure. High risk with direct contact of the cases, and relatively low risk with indirect contact with the cases. The population at risk, those who are not falling in these two categories, that is the population at risk, and these are the individual or community not falling in the category of suspect or contacts, they are the population at risk. Now we will describe in somewhat detail what to do with the contacts, suspects, and the population at risk. According to GOP, the suspect category 1 is defined as a patient with acute respiratory illness, fever, and at least one sign or symptom of respiratory disease like cough, shortness of breath, and with no other etiology that fully explain the clinical presentation, plus the history of travel or residence in country or area of territory reporting the local cases. So this is first category. Then B category is a patient with acute respiratory illness and having been in contact with a confirmed case or probable case of COVID-19 case in last 14 days prior to the onset of symptoms. So this is B category of suspect. Then C category of suspect include the patient with severe acute respiratory infection, fever, and at least one sign symptom of respiratory disease, cough, shortness of breath, and requiring hospitalization and with no other etiology fully explained the clinical presentation. So this is the C category. Then suspect of D category, any person died having sign and symptoms of COVID-19 illness in the area with ongoing transmission of infection, or have definitive epidemiological link with the probable or confirmed COVID-19 patient. So these are four categories of suspects, and all the suspects must be screened. Then what are the contacts? The contacts are the person having direct or indirect physical contact with the person who were having COVID-19 positive diagnostic test. So they are the contacts, the first level contact, as already explained, direct contact, and level 2 with indirect. Now what are the level 1 contacts, the condition meeting with the level 1 contact? The person providing direct care for COVID-19 patients and working with healthcare worker infected with COVID-19, number 2, and visiting the confirmed positive case of COVID-19 patient. A person having had face-to-face contact of having been in closed environment with the COVID-19 patient. Traveling together with COVID-19 patient in any kind of conveyance, and living in the same household of COVID-19 patients. So this is a high risk category, level 1 category of the contacts. Then contacts of level 2 category, an identified person having a casual contact with an ambulant COVID-19 case, or a person having stayed in an area presumed to have ongoing community transmission, is these are the level 2 contacts. Now what to do, how to proceed with the contact and suspects. The contact management protocol is isolate and transfer the contact to the quarantine area under standard SOP and infection control measures. So for the contact, they must be immediately sent to quarantine. The registration of contacts at quarantine facility with all details and contact history. All contacts are entry screening, medical as well as lab. Educate, explain, and provide psychological counseling. So this is how the you have to deal with the contacts. Then screening of contacts and suspects. Testing should be performed using real-time PCR on nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal swab specimens. The serology immunoglobulins are not recommended as primary mean of diagnosis. They may be used as a mean of diagnosis, but they are not for the confirmatory purpose according to the guidelines. The presence of fever or cough or shortness of breath or any of the following international travel in last 14 days need the screening, the subjected to screening. The household contact with asymptomatic international travelers, close contact with the confirmed or probable case of COVID-19, caregiver of a person with the pneumonia or suspect etiology, unspecified etiology, engaged in public dealing, bank tellers, general physicians, and then participated in large congregations, and healthcare workers involved, where the care of confirmed case with COVID-19 patients care of patient with pneumonia and unspecified etiology, the point of entry like outpatient department, emergency, reception, registration and counters. So this is how the contact can occur through these congregations. They are all subjected to the screening with the real-time PCR as per protocols. Then screening of the contacts, suspects and real-time PCR nasopharyngeal swab will divide the population into segregate the cases into three categories. Number one, those who are positive, COVID-19 positive, they are the cases. COVID-19 inconclusive, they are the probable cases. And COVID-19 negative, the individual at high risk of exposure. So these three categories are evolved as a result of screening. So the cases are divided as asymptomatic with mild symptoms, moderate symptoms, severe and critical patients. Then probable case, they are acute, they may have the acute respiratory illness, but they must be treated in isolation as suspect and the test must be repeated for them. Similarly, those who are negative contact, they should be given self-quarantine or self-isolation for 14 days. And suspect should repeat if they this symptom appear, they should the test must be repeated. So these are this is the protocol for this. Now the COVID-19 cases category, as I have already talked about the category of cases, the confirmed case. A person with a laboratory confirmed by COVID-19 infection, irrespective of clinical sign, is the confirmed case. Asymptomatic, a person with a laboratory confirmation of COVID-19 but not showing any clinical sign and symptom is asymptomatic case. Then mild symptom, a person with a confirmed COVID-19 infection having mild clinical sign and symptoms. Severe symptoms, a person with laboratory confirmed COVID-19 infection and have the severe clinical sign. These severe, mild and moderate, they are in the national guideline of clinical case management. They are defined categorically in national guidelines. So the national guidelines should be consulted, which symptoms and signs will the patient will fall into which category. Now the COVID response action, this is very important. Okay, how we have to take the action when we have screened the population and how we will proceed for the response. So the response is cyclic in nature, and first we start with the suspects and contacts. We have to segregate from the community the suspects and contacts. Then COVID-19 positive includes this segment is those on which the screening test has been exercised. Screening test has been have to be exercised on suspect and contacts, and these are those in which the screening test have been attempted. And this is the community which is still supposed to be unexposed, but they are at on the risk. Now, what to do with this category? They should be subjected to screening through nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal swab. And if all the suspect and contacts, they must be have the quarantine, self-quarantine are legal quarantine in case of travelers is essential. So this is the response here at this segment. And when the results are received for the PCR, this is before receiving the results of PCR. When the results are received, then patient may be asymptomatic positive. For the asymptomatic positive, the actions are recommended home isolation, keep watch over the symptoms, and keep telephonic consultation, go on consultation. If the symptoms progress to moderate to severe, then call for the doctor for hospitalization, or if the condition is worsening, then the hospitalization is required. Inconclusive or negative case, the home quarantine or home isolation is recommended. Repeat the test for negative and inconclusive persons are probable cases, and up till that period, treat the illness in isolation to be as a probable case of COVID-19. Then the symptomatic positive cases, for mild symptoms, home isolation treatment at home, and keep in contact with the health facility or hospitals. Then moderate or in severe patients, treatment in isolation protocol with all infection control protocols in the hospitals. So this is what to respond about the symptomatic positive cases. And here I again remind the clinical case management guideline, national guideline, must be consulted for this and must be followed. Then lastly, the community population at risk. All the community, they should be subjected to social distancing for the prevention, and to improve the nutrition, body defense, and personal protection measures should be taken whenever the fear of exposure. Then self observation, reporting as suspect, and reporting for contacts. It is the responsibility of the community to tell them or to categorize them as contact and suspects, because nobody is seeing when the symptom are there and when the person is having the contact with the COVID-19 patients. This is the responsibility of citizens to report as contact and suspect. Then they will be subjected to, they will fall into this category. So this cycle will be repeated like this, and this is the exactly COVID-19 disease surveillance and response protocol. The intervention, we will talk about some of the interventions which are mentioned in disease surveillance response. Legal quarantine. What is legal quarantine? The traveler or the visitors of pandemic outbreak areas of COVID-19 are legally detained for the period of 14 days at the specific designated accommodation at entry points, such as airport and seaports. So this is the quarantine. This is the legal quarantine, and this is under the international health regulation. Then home quarantine, when a close contact or suspect or confirmed case of COVID-19 is separated in his home for 14 days with restricted movement and interaction with the other members of the family and general public, curtail the spread of the disease. For this is the home quarantine. That means this will be decided through the consultation of the healthcare providers and the patient themselves. This is the home quarantine. Now, what to do in self-isolation and home quarantine? Stay home except when getting medical care. And there is complete separation. Separate room is required. Strict partition is required from the other people of at home. Avoid sharing the household items. Wash hand fast with soap for 20 seconds and sanitize with the alcohol. Then cover your cough and sneeze with the tissue. Wear a face mask when closed sides facing outward, and keep distance from the animals. Call ahead before visiting your doctors. So these are the tips for the instructions for those people who go into home isolation and self quarantine. Now, what is home isolation? The home isolation implies to restrict the movement and interaction of confirmed positive case with mild symptom under home setting. Then isolation at health facility. When the patient is admitted, then it is the responsibility of the healthcare providers. For patient of confirmed COVID-19, they should be treated in isolation and strictly recommended protocol of treatment of healthcare facility. And they should follow the IPC, infection protection measures, as per protocol of the facility are recommended nationally and internationally. The purpose of isolation is to keep infected people away from those who are not infected. So this is the isolation. Then social distancing. The social distancing to practice social or physical distances among the people to avoid the direct contact transmission and droplet transmission, and minimum recommended criteria is the 6 feet by CDC and WHO. And the instructions are stay at least 6 feet or 2 meters from the people. Do not gather in groups. Stay out of crowded places and avoid mass gathering. So this is the protocol of social distancing. Then what are the tips for social distancing? Stay home is the best, but if you have to work, then try to work from home. Then avoid crowds and avoid the social gathering, and avoid the handshaking, and avoid meal gathering, tea parties or marriage parties or other all parties. So the government has also taken these actions at their side. But this is the responsibility, social distancing responsibility is the government should aware the population about the social distancing. So this is the key intervention on the population at risk. Next, frequently asked questions. At the end, the most of the population, they are asking the question, what is the difference between home quarantine and home isolation? In this regard, the home quarantine, people who have exposed to virus have the contact and don't have the symptoms. So they are liable to home quarantine. And home isolation, people who think they have the virus or have tested positive for virus, they are the patients. They should be isolated at home, and at least 7 days from the onset of the symptoms. But home quarantine is strictly for 14 days. It is for the contacts and it is for the patients. Then more frequently asked questions regarding social distancing, self-quarantine and isolation. Who can contact? For social distancing, roommates, family members you live, they can contact. But in quarantine and isolation, stay in a room alone. If you live with the people in your house, if you live alone, that means if you have living alone in the home, then it is okay. But if you are living with family members, then you need separate room. Get supplies, deliveries by drop-off. Don't touch or talk to the person delivering the things. Then what you can do, you can go solitary walk, hike or jog, but keeping the distance. And then let employees work from home. In self quarantine and isolation, stock up food and water and have to deliver, and don't interact with the delivery persons. How to socialize? Cancel any unnecessary gathering plans. Don't leave your house aside from emergencies. No face-to-face interaction and keep distance of 6 feet. Phone calls and virtual communications are acceptable. So these are some of the some more frequently asked question about like personal protection. The frequently asked, should you wear the mask? Yes. If you have respiratory symptoms or difficulty in breathing, you must wear the face mask. Yes, if you are providing care individual with respiratory symptoms. If you are health worker and attending the individual with symptoms, then the face mask is essential. Then next, personal protection as per infection protection protocols or control measures. The healthcare providers must wear according to the clinical, according to the recommended protocols of the health facilities. So these are the preventive measures. Thank you very much for listening to this seminar.